So, welcome everybody to this lecture 26 of UHP2. In the last lecture, we had started discussing about this all-encompassing resolution, and a sub-part of this all-encompassing resolution, what we call as science. So we talked about science in general, right? And we identified that this science has to do with science of behavior, science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. Then we discussed in little detail about the science of behavior. In continuation with that, today we want to discuss in some detail about the science of work and science of participation in the larger order. So this is what we intend to look into today. So if you look at the overall scheme that we have been working on, we have been talking about the human desire, which is continuous happiness, which is the need of the self. And this continuous happiness is fulfilled by right understanding, right feeling, and right thought. That's what we are calling as the resolution, which are the activity of the self. And then we said that this right feeling and right thought, which we are calling as the resolution, essentially calls for having the clarity of all aspects of human existence. So all these 9 aspects that we had identified, which were important for our existence as a human being, we need to have the clarity of all these if we have to be resolved within. In other words, if we have the right feeling and right thought based on right understanding, then we will have clarity about all this. So we were trying to look into this, you know, in detail regarding the clarity of each of these. So we talked about right understanding. We talked about wisdom as identification of human goal. And now we are talking about science, science which has to do with how to fulfill human goal. So this is what we have started discussing. We discussed this science as such, you know, yesterday. And there we also discuss about science of behavior in particular, as I mentioned. So this human living has to do with understanding, which is in the block B1, then human thought, right, which is at the level of B2. And then we have this expression, human behavior and work, and participation, which is at the level of world outside. So we talked about understanding, we talked about wisdom, and now we are talking about science. Right? So if you look at science, we said this is the details about the expression of living in coexistence. And if you look at this coexistence, it is in the form of units submerged in space, and an unfolding of this existence is in the form of nature, where we can see the harmony, where every unit is self-organized and every unit is participating in the larger order. So this participation in the larger order is what we are talking about, participation in larger order. And this relationship, you know, this coexistence, this existence is expressing itself in the form of nature, which is expressing itself in the form of relationship between units in nature. So this relationship can be seen at the level of human-human relationship and human-rest of nature relationship. So this human-human relationship is what we are calling as behavior, and this human-rest of nature is what we are calling as work. And this is what we are trying to understand under this science. So we are trying to understand how we will express ourselves in coexistence, in existence, in nature, in relationship, in terms of our behavior, our work, and our participation in the larger order. Therefore, we said that science has to do with these three things. So essentially, how to ensure fulfillment of human goal, it has to deal with this. It starts, its expectation is detailing. And this detailing will include all these things, the plan, the program, the implementation, the results. And we will have this science of behavior, science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. So this we have discussed in the last class. And we discussed about the science of behavior in some detail. Now we want to work on the science of work and science of participation in the larger order in this session today. So let us look at that. So the science of work has to do with our work with rest of nature, leading to mutual prosperity. So basically, when we are trying to understand ourselves, the rest of nature, and our relationship with rest of nature, then understanding this relationship of human being with rest of nature, and interacting with rest of nature in a manner that it leads to mutual enrichment, mutual prosperity. So working out the details of how to ensure fulfillment of my relationship with rest of nature is what we are calling as science of work. If that is clear, then we can see that this understanding of relationship of human being with rest of nature and working out the details of how to fulfill this relationship with rest of nature, it leads to mutual enrichment, mutual prosperity. So if I have this clarity, the details of how to go about ensuring my relationship with rest of nature, and if I work on the basis of this, it must result into mutual enrichment, mutual prosperity. That means if I look at the details of how to go about ensuring this relationship, and that is what we are calling as science, working out the details, then we can see that we have to ensure these two things. Number one, we have to ensure prosperity in human being. And number two, we have to ensure preservation of nature. So preservation of rest of nature and prosperity in human being. These are the two things that we have to take care of. And if we have to take care of this two, that is prosperity in human being and preservation of rest of nature, then there are some details which we have to take care of. So while ensuring prosperity in human being, the first and foremost requirement is that I am able to identify my need of physical facility. So what all are needed and in what quantity? So identification of required physical facility with required quantity is the first and foremost thing in ensuring prosperity in human being. Once I am able to identify my need of physical facility with required quantity, second thing is production of it by way of labor, by way of my work with rest of nature. And while I am doing production and work, I have to ensure that I am using cyclic and mutually enriching process. Then only it will lead to mutual enrichment with rest of nature. If I don't ensure this need for mutual enrichment will be violated. And while I am ensuring this mutual enrichment with rest of nature, I must ensure justice for the people involved in the process of production. So I put that in bracket. Yet the main issue here is ensuring cyclic and mutually enriching process with rest of nature so that I can ensure mutual enrichment, mutual prosperity. But while doing this, I also have to take care of the justice. Justice that we were talking about in science of behavior. So there we have to ensure justice, right, with other human beings in each and every condition. And this is one such condition when I am working with rest of nature and where I am involving other people in the process of production. So that, you know, science of behavior which we have been discussing, that has to be included and that has to be ensured even when we are talking about science of work. So that behavior part has also been taken care of in the process of production. In fact, the whole production process should be such design that it facilitates the science of work. At least it does not hamper it. Now we have this physical facility with us. We have identified our need. We have ensured this physical facility more than what is required. Now there is importance of right utilization. And as we have talked about in UHP1 itself, that this right utilization of physical facility is something very important. Because unless we see the right utilization of it, right, unless we are able to working on it and we are able to ensure it, we are never able to define our need for physical facility. So in the very process of defining our need for physical facility, we have to bring in this issue of right utilization of physical facility. Only when you go about ensuring the right utilization, you find that there are many things pending with you, accumulated in you, with you, which are not being used at all, right? That you can verify in your own house, in your own family, that how much is accumulated and are they all put to right use or they are just accumulated because of some wrong assumptions or wrong inferences. So when it comes to right utilization, one important outcome of this is that I am able to identify the need of my physical facility. The other important thing is that I am able to rightly utilize the physical facility. Therefore, I do not overconsume. I do not indulge. Right? That idea of getting happiness through sensation, right, does not come in. I am using the physical facility. Ensuring its right utilization means I am using it for the purpose of nurturing of the body, for the protection of the body, that is ensuring the health of the body, and for the purpose of fulfillment of some goal of the self. That is sharing my knowledge, sharing my feelings. So that is the purpose for which I will use the physical facility, and that will be the right utilization. And if I do that, I can see it is possible for me to ensure the identification of the required physical facility. And it is also possible for us to ensure the fulfillment of this requirement and still have enough to share with others. When we are not doing right utilization and we are overconsumed, indulge, right, then two problems come in. Number one is that we deprive others, right, from having those physical facility and make right use of it. And number two, we start taxing on the nature, rest of nature. So we start with exploitation of nature that we will see, you know, as we go on. And the last thing is that we have to ensure the exchange and storage of whatever is being produced excess, you know, extra, for the purpose of mutual fulfillment. For the purpose of mutual fulfillment. So these are the issues of importance while ensuring prosperity in human being. Similarly, while ensuring preservation of rest of nature, the important issues are enrichment of rest of nature, protection of rest of nature, and right utilization of rest of nature. So we have to ensure that the enrichment takes place of the rest of nature with which we are interacting. We have to ensure that this nature, the rest of nature, is protected when I'm interacting with it. And third is that this rest of nature is being rightly utilized and not misutilized. So not only the physical facility that I have responsibility to rightly utilize it, but I also have the responsibility to rightly utilize whatever rest of nature I see around, and particularly those which I'm interacting with in my work, in my production. So if you remember in EHB1, when we are talking about harmony in society, we did talk about this work and production. We define this work as the labor a human being does on the rest of nature, and this production as the physical facility obtained out of this work. And we also saw that when we are talking about production and work, there are two important issues. One is what to produce, and the other is how to produce. So these are two very important issues. So let us recall them, you know, let us have some discussion so that we can get a better feel about the science of work. So when you look at what to produce, the answer is required physical facility. Required physical facility is necessary for nurturing, protection, and right utilization of the body. So if you remember, this right utilization of the body essentially calls for referring to the purpose of the self for which the body will be rightly utilized. So three things we are using it for, the physical facility. One is for nurturing and protection of the body, so ensuring the health of the body. And also using the body for the purpose of fulfillment of the need of the self or goal of the self in terms of sharing my knowledge, my feeling with other human beings, or participating in the societal order. So this is what we have to produce and not otherwise. Second is how to produce. And when we are talking about how to produce, we said it has to be produced through mutually enriching cyclic processes. Mutually enriching cyclic processes. We'll see into the detail. So that is what we are saying in other terms. It is eco-friendly. And second condition is that it has to ensure justice. At least ensure justice with the people who are involved in this process of production, process of work. That means it has to be people friendly. So these are the two issues relating to production and work, what to produce and how to produce. And we have talked about, you know, it in some detail in UHB1. So if you look at this mutually enriching and cyclic process, there are two requirements. One is that it is cyclic. The other is that every unit in the process is enriched. So if you look at the interaction between the soil and the plant, you can see that soil enriches the plants because the plants shall grow on soil. And when the leaves of plants fall down, the fruits, the flowers, and they are, you know, degenerated in the soil tends to get more fertile. So you can see that the soil is enriching the plant and plant is enriching the soil. So this we have seen, right? We have also seen that this mutually enriching cyclic process is already going on in the nature. This process is already going on in the nature. I don't have to create this process. I don't have to create this process. Right. I only have to understand it and be with it. I only have to understand it and be with it. So we can see this, that the processes are already there, already going on. I do not have to really try, you know, creating these processes in nature. These processes are already going on in nature. We just have to understand these processes and live accordingly. And second thing that we have to do is that when we understand these processes and live accordingly, then whenever we are developing any process, right, from our side, we have to make sure that this is also mutually enriching and cyclic process as going on in the nature and not otherwise. So this is our contribution. So if you look at this, all the four orders in nature, the physical order, the bio order, the animal order, and the human order, this interaction between the first three orders is mutually enriching among themselves, and they are also mutually, they are also enriching for the human being. But when it comes to the question of whether human beings are mutually enriching with rest of these three orders or not, there is a question mark. So that is where we are. So there are three question marks, right? From human being to soil, water, and air, from human being to plants and trees, from human beings to animals, birds. There is a question mark. So when we are saying that we will develop the processes of production which are mutually enriching and cyclic, is the natural processes, then we'll be able to take care of this mutual fulfillment, or my mutual fulfillment with the rest of nature. So we'll be able to put a right mark there in place of a question of, you know, putting a question mark there. So we have to either develop such processes, or if we have some processes which are not satisfying this, we'll have to update those processes. So this is one important thing relating to this science of work. Now, with this background, if you look at the issues of concern with the science of work, then these are the issues that we have just mentioned. So when we are saying, let us look at the issues of concern and the science of work and also evaluate whether these issues are taken care of today or not. So this science of work has to do with work with rest of nature leading to mutual prosperity, which essentially means or calls for this prosperity in human being and preservation of the rest of nature. And this prosperity of human being calls for this 1.1 to 1.5. And this preservation of nature calls for 2.1 to 2.3. Therefore, science of work has to deal with all these issues, even if we limit the science to physical world and not take care of the world of consciousness. So this is interesting. You know, this we saw that science now in general will call for science of behavior, science of work, science of participation in the larger order. So if you look at the science that we are talking about today, right, it is not really able to take care of the science of behavior and science of participation in the larger order. It is talking about science of work only. And there also, it is talking about science of work in a very limited sense. So that we will see as we go along. So we are saying that even if science is limiting itself to the physical world, that is, it is talking about science of work only, right? Even there, it has to take care of all these issues, 1.5 to 1.5, 1.1 to 1.5, and 2.1 to 2.3. So in the light of this, we can evaluate the present science, right? Or science we do today. So if you look at the present state of science of work and production, we have identified the issues of concern for science of work. Let us now evaluate whether these issues of concern are taken care of by science of work today or not. So these are the issues that we have to look into and find out whether they are taken care of or not. So let us do a little bit of investigation analysis. So we'll evaluate one by one whether these issues of concern are taken care of by science of work today or not. Right. Number one is prosperity in human being. Under that, identification of required physical facility with required quantity. This is not taken care of, that we can see. If you ask yourself, right, you will get this answer. That this identification of required physical facility with required quantity is not taken care of today in the study of science, right, which is limited to science of work. But even there, this identification of physical facility or need of physical facility is not taken care of. In the whole process of education, there is no content dealing with identification of need of physical facility. That you can see, right? 20 years of education, 30 years of education, right? There seems to be no content, of course, no process, where identification of need of physical facility is addressed. It is implicitly assumed that this need is infinite. And what is promoted is more and more consumption. So if you go through this present system of education, and particularly when you are going through professional education, staying in a hostel, you can see what is being, you know, promoted. The identification of need of physical facility and the right utilization of it, or consumption, more and more consumption, more and more indulgence. And we can see that the same is the case at the level of society. Same is the case at the level of society. Instead of helping the individuals to identify their need of physical facility, what is promoted is consumption indulgence. Number two, 1.2, production by way of labor. The mentality of production by putting in labor is not promoted in education or in society. That we can see, verify for yourself. Right? If this is not correct, correct it, you know, set it right. But this is our observation. But you have to make your own observation and see whether this is the case or not. Everybody going through education is looking for a white collar job. That is a job which does not call for labor, only management. So are we also doing the same thing? Third is using cyclic and mutually enriching process, ensuring justice for people involved in the process. Now, if you look at the production process that we are using today, most of our production processes today are not cyclic and mutually enriching. And this leads to problems of pollution and resource depletion. And that we will see that because of lack of this cyclic and mutually enriching process, we are ending up with this such an acute problem of pollution and this resource depletion, which is almost causing the breakdown of the environment of the earth. We can also see that we are not also very aware of ensuring justice for the people involved in the process. So ensuring justice for the people who are involved in the process, we don't seem to be very concerned about it. Rather, most of our systems of management are focused on maximization of profit, and they are willing to work with the principle of opposition in place of that of relationship. So they don't even accept that this, you know, relationship is something very fundamental, and we have to ensure relationship in the process of production with other human beings. That is, we have to ensure justice. What is of concern for most of these management principles is maximization of profit. But don't take this statement as a, you know, statement of truth. Just take it as an, you know, observation and try to verify it for yourself whether this is the case or not. Then we have this 1.4, the right utilization of physical facility. This again is not taken care of because in the whole process of education, there is no content dealing with right utilization of physical facility. Rather, consumption to the extent of indulgence is implicitly promoted. So that you can see, I keep quoting this example of celebrating birthday, you know, in this engineering colleges. So at 12 o'clock in the night, they will have two big cake. Right? The first cake they will, you know, put on the face of this person whose birthday has been celebrated, right? On the face and all over the body, and then give bumps. Right? And then the remaining cake they will eat all together. Now the first part is by no means right utilization. In fact, what is promoted is, you know, misutilization and indulgence. I mean, quite futile thing to do, but we are doing it because that is how is, you know, thing environment is created. That is what is, you know, kind of assumption created around. So when the student comes fresh, they find it very funny, very, you know, kind of unexplainable. But after one semester, they also start doing it and they think that they are doing something very meaningful. So the same is seen at the level of society where consumption is defined as a status and is praised for. So this is still worse. That not only that you are allowing misutilization or creating an environment for misutilization or overindulgence, right? In this society, this is what is being praised for. This is what is defined as status. So if you are consuming more and more, you are more developed. So this is the standard for the individuals in the society, set up by the society. And it is also the standard now of measuring how developed a nation is. Just observations, you know, just observations. Don't take them as given truth, as I said. But do analyze them. Do, you know, observe them and make your own judgment. I am mentioning this not to condemn this system, you know, present, but I am mentioning them with a view that if it comes to your notice, then at least you can start doing something for setting it right. And what is right is what we have already discussed, right? With that framework, we are talking about this. So what we have to do, we have already talked about it. What we are doing, now we are trying to analyze in the light of that. So we have talked about the resolution, the solution, and in the light of that solution, now we are evaluating the present status and trying to identify the problem. And our suggestion would certainly be that what we have to do is not just keep, you know, criticizing these problems, but work for the solution. And what is the solution? It's what we have already talked about. So your attention may go for the solution. With that view, we are looking at the status today and seeing that the present status is that full of problems. But the emphasis is not on problems and talking about problems. The emphasis is on understanding the solution and working for it. So the fifth point is that exchange and storage for mutual fulfillment. Right? This issue also is not dealt with properly, it seems. The exchange and storage of things produced is, of course, done. So you are doing exchange, you are doing storage. But if you look at the motivation behind it, it is not mutual fulfillment, but profit maximization or even exploitation. So in majority of the case, the motivation behind this exchange and storage seems to be not that of mutual fulfillment, but of profit maximization and even exploitation. In fact, many times, hoarding is done in the name of storage for the purpose of creating shortage and for getting more and more profit. This you all know, so I don't have to explain. Then the remaining three things, let's look at them. This 2.1, the enrichment of rest of nature. Are we taking care of it? So enrichment of rest of nature is not at our focus in the present day. Right? Rather, we are willing to exploit the natural resources used in the process and even the natural environment. Right? So we are willing to exploit the natural resources that we are using in the process, and we are even willing to exploit the whole environment, the natural environment. That is quite clear. So we are digging out mines without ensuring their protection, without ensuring their enrichment. Right. And when we have to dig mines, we have to cut trees, we have to dig mountains. So in the process, we are destroying the forest, we are destroying the mountain, and so many things. Right. The simple example of farming that we do today, right? The inorganic farming, where we are willing to produce at the cost of fertility and other quality of the soil. So the quality of the soil is deteriorating. The fertility is going down, but we are busy trying to get more and more production. Similarly, if we look at this protection of the rest of nature, the protection seems to be of concern only to the extent that is very necessary for immediate production. For example, putting fertilizer in the soil to get the immediate production And many times it is even at the cost of other qualities of the soil. For example, see the case of cancer in Bathinda district of Punjab. So protection is not our concern, it seems. We only want to do that much of protection which is necessary for immediate production. So for example, if the fertility of the soil is going down, then we will not get the production. So let us do something for the fertility. And what we do is put in some chemical fertilizer. But, you know, and some, of course, insecticide and pesticides to give kind of protection to the crop. But in the process, many qualities of the soil is going down. And in fact, it is becoming very harming. So if you look at this case of Bathinda district, where the first agricultural university came up in 60s, today the situation is that the condition of the soil, the condition of the water, and the condition of air is so deteriorated, so bad, that it is causing cancer to the people there. In fact, it seems that almost every family has at least one member who is suffering from cancer. So there are details, I'm not going to them, you know, but you can find out for yourself. The third thing is 2.3, that is right utilization of the rest of nature. As discussed in the case of physical facility, right utilization does not seem to be of concern either at the level of education or at the level of society. Rather, overconsumption is what is promoted. So these are some of the kind of analysis or observation about the present status of science of work and production. But look at them, observe them yourself, and make your own analysis about all these 1.1 to 1.5 and 2.1 to 2.3. Of course, this leads to resource depletion and pollution, right? So this you can look through. So it can be seen that both these problems are due to the involvement of process which is either not cyclic or not mutually enriching. And these problems can be solved if we start using the processes which are cyclic and mutually enriching. So with this, you know, kind of observation about the science of work, okay, now we can move on to this science of participation in the larger order. So if you look at this science of participation in the larger order, which is in terms of five dimensions of human order leading to fulfillment of human goal, right? Let's look at that. So if you recall, when we're talking about harmony in society, we did talk about these four human goals, right? And the fulfillment of these four human goals through these five dimensions of the system. Right. So now we can see that when we talk about the science of participation in the larger order, we have to talk about how we can participate in these five systems to ensure the fulfillment of these four human goals. So this is the scope of science of participation in the larger order. So we have to work out how these five systems or five dimensions of human order, right, can ensure the fulfillment of these four human goals. So detailing of these five systems and how this can ensure the fulfillment of one or the many goals out of these four human goals. And similarly, we can see that it is to be done not only at the level of family or a village, but it has to be done at the level of nation and ultimately at the level of whole world. So that is what we are saying, that we have to understand, talk about the details of this five dimensions of social order, and also how it has to be fulfilled, starting from family order to the nation order and ultimately to the world order. At least we have to talk about it at the level of family order and the level of village order, because that village seems to be the minimum unit of the social order. So if you look at this in little details, which we have talked about in ESB1, but I will recall this, you know, for your ready reference without going into much detail. So we did talk about this human participation in the order of nature, right? So if you look at the whole nature, and if you look at the placement of human being in this nature, in this existence, then we can see what human being has to ensure in terms of its participation in the human order, its participation in the order of nature. So if you recall, we said, in a sense, this participation would mean to understand the inherent harmony in nature and to live accordingly. That is to facilitate a conducive environment for the activity of all orders. So we facilitate a conducive environment for the activity of physical order, bio order, and so on. At least we do not violate it. So this is one important thing. Second is to facilitate the innateness, or at least not violate it, of all orders. And third is to facilitate the inheritance of all orders. So in other words, we have to ensure mutual fulfillment with all orders of nature. And that mutual fulfillment will call for, you know, providing a conducive environment for the activity of that order, for all orders, to facilitate the innateness of all orders, and to facilitate the inheritance of all orders. If we can do this, we can ensure the mutual fulfillment with all orders in nature. So some of the details are given below. For example, facilitating the physical order would mean facilitate its existence, that is the innateness, by ensuring conducive environment and maintaining, ensuring its constitution. For example, constitution of earth. So while we are interacting with the earth, we have to take care of the constitution of the earth. We have to make sure that we don't disturb it, right? So we ensure its existence by ensuring conducive environment in terms of ensuring its constitution of earth, not disturbing it at least. Similarly, when we are interacting with the pranic order, we have to facilitate its growth by ensuring conducive environment and maintaining its seeds. So the seeds have to continue, right? If we want to preserve any pranic order, any bio order, and we have to facilitate its growth. So like that, when it comes to human order, we have to facilitate care of the body by ensuring physical facility and the environment for existence and growth of the body, and facilitate its will to live with continuous happiness by ensuring right understanding and right feeling, right, through human education and sanskar. So like that, you know, we have talked about this in some detail in EHP1. So we can recall some of this for ready reference here. And if necessary, we can work out further details. We have also mentioned about the feelings that are basic to this participation in the larger order. So if you remember, we talked about these six feelings, right, which are essential for participating in the human order. the perseverance, the brevity, the generosity. So when we understand the harmony in nature, we have the commitment for living in harmony, right, with patience. Then we have commitment for helping the others to understand this harmony and to live in this harmony in nature. And generosity is my commitment to invest myself, body and physical facility for understanding and living in this harmony in nature, myself and helping others for this purpose. So I have to have these feelings of perseverance, brevity and generosity. And more than that, I have to have this feeling of kindness, beneficence and compassion. And this compassion is what we were talking about, helping the other unconditionally to develop the competence as well as the means to fulfill his needs when he neither has the capability nor the means. So I have this feeling of being related to all, and I have this feeling of responsibility towards all. Right? That feeling of responsibility towards all is what we are calling as compassion. And if we have this feeling, we'll be willing to help the other unconditionally. If he has the competence and feel, not having the means, we'll provide the means. If he has the means and not competence, then we'll provide the competence, or at least help him to develop his competence. And if he does not have both the competence and the means, we'll like to help him to develop his competence, and develop these means so that he can ensure the fulfillment of his own needs. So this is helping the other unconditionally. That is the feeling of compassion. All these feelings have to be there at the base to ensure this participation in the larger order. And if you do not have these feelings, and if you only have trying to provide any structure, by law and by regulations, it is not going to work. That we have seen amply when we are talking about this. The human values about the participation of human being in this existence. So to, make a little detailed description of it, we are talking about this participation of human being in different dimensions of human order. So we'll make a brief presentation of it just to draw your attention towards them so that you can start exploring. They will be discussed in more detail in another elective course, UHP3. So this part issue of participation and even the issue of relationship is discussed quite in detail in another course, by the name UHP3, that is offered in the next semester. So there we will discuss in more detail about this participation of human being in different dimensions of human order. But we'll just present some part of it for you to start exploring now so that you can make a better, observation when we start with UHP3. So some of the dimensions which we can identify of human order for our participation are education, health, justice, production and service, exchange and distribution, right utilization, preservation, services, both administrative and social. So these are the dimensions which can be immediately identified, and which we need to work. In fact, we are already working on it, these dimensions, whether they are complete or not, whether they are proper or not is an issue. But we are working on all these dimensions that we have mentioned right here. So if you really understand this, the role of human being in this existence, the participation of human being in this existence, then you can see what we need to do at the level of each of these dimensions. So I'll just briefly mention for you to reflect on without going into much detail. And if there are questions relating to this, we can certainly take up those questions after this presentation is over. So we have this dimension of education and health. So education plays an important role in ensuring human order. Education builds the ability, the competence for right understanding, right thought, and right behavior in every person. It enables one to behave properly with other human beings and work with mutual fulfillment with the rest of nature, and thereby contribute to the human order or human system. So this is what education, dimension of education has to ensure. Similarly, dimension of health has to take care of health of the human body. When this dimension is functioning well, people lead a life which is conducive to good health. So all these details we can see, dimension of education and dimension of health and dimension of justice and dimension of production and service. So we have to take care of both the production and the services. So activities which involves the production of physical facility and activities which are not involving the production of physical facility, but it has to be taken care of when it relates to human being and the human body. Right. So for example, cutting hair is not producing something, but it is essential service, right, that has to be taken care of. So all this details we can see. Then we have the dimension of exchange, dimension of right utilization, and the preservation, the service, and in service we have both the administrative service and social service. So all these details we can look into. So we have just presented a brief count of it, which can be discussed further, as I said, in the next course. But I think looking at the time, not discussing even this brief account. But these are provided in this slide and you can go through it, and if there are questions, we can take them up. And this dimension of systems and attainment of human objectives. So these dimensions can be evaluated on the basis of whether they are able to achieve this human objective, the human goal ultimately or not. With this brief discussion about science of work and science of participation, and of course the science of behavior, which we have already discussed in the last session, now we can make an overall evaluation of the present system, present state of science. So what we are doing in the name of science, we can just make a brief evaluation of this. So let's look at that. We have seen that science in its broader terms is defined as how to ensure fulfillment of human goals, its thought, its expectation, its detailing. And this detailing includes plan, program, and implementation, result, and evaluation of this program, this plan. Right? In that sense, we said science has to take care of all three. Science of behavior, science of work, science of participation in the larger order. So this is science has to take care of. So now if you look at the science today, we can see what it is doing and what it is not doing. So if you look at that, however, if you look at the present day science, it is not paying much attention to science of behavior and science of participation in the larger order. This is more or less clear, but you can look into this and see whether this statement is true or not true. In fact, if you look at the effort today, there are some scattered efforts to include this science of behavior. Okay. So we are now talking about the science of psychology and social science and things like that. But it does not seem to be very well investigated into, and not put in the process of education with that seriousness. Right? So for example, if you ask yourself with 20 years of education in science and engineering and such professional discipline, how much you have been exposed to this science of behavior and science of participation in the larger effort. So this is part one. The part two is that even this whole, you know, when you are talking about science of work and not talking about science of behavior and science of participation, even when you are talking about science of work, are we talking about this with all its dimensions, with all its aspects? Right? If you look at that, we find that even the whole dealing with science of work, its approach is quite limited, as we discussed in this session only. So we have already discussed this, that even the science of work is not taking care of all aspects of science of work. Right? So starting from 1.1 to 1.5 and then 2.1 to 2.3, we saw whether the science of work today is able to take care, or the science today in general is able to take care of all these aspects of science of work or not. Hence, we need to broaden the scope of science, right? And how do we do it? We can broaden the scope of science that we are doing today by including consciousness and space as reality of concern along with the material. So today our major concern seems to be the material reality, but of course there is reality of consciousness and there is reality of space. So we need to include those as our concern, right, when we are talking about science. And second is including the study of relationship, harmony and coexistence at the level of these realities of existence as a whole. So when we are looking at the material reality, the consciousness and the space, particularly the units of material and consciousness, we have to study about the relationship, about the harmony, and about the coexistence, right? Then we'll be able to understand the existence better, the nature better, the relationship better, right? And therefore deal with the science in general, in its broader terms. We'll be able to take care of science of behavior, science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. So this is in a sense what I wanted to present in this session. Before I open for question, let me just draw your attention towards some points of self-reflection. Remember the last session we had put this point, but now you can recall this. We have seen that science can be expanded as science of behavior, work, and participation. In the present science, day science, are we taking care of all three? That is science of behavior, work, and participation. Or we are only taking care of the science of work, right, in all aspect of it. Or we are only taking care of the science of work in only some limited aspect of it. So this you have to explore yourself. We from our side have already made some observations, but you have to explore it for yourself. In the science of participation, what do you see as your role at different levels, family order to nation to world family order? So this participation of human being at different levels of human order, family order to nation to world family order, we have just talked about. Now you have to find out what do you see as your role at these different levels. And also you can ask yourself, does the present education system prepare you for these roles? So there will be many roles which you can identify, right, in terms of your participation at the level of family order, at the level of village order, at the level of nation order, and so on. Then we have to ask, does our present education system preparing us for these roles? Right? And if it is not preparing, then what changes is required in the present education system? So just broad points for your self-reflection. So with this, I will